Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I think we got a great Friday show for you. Thanks so much for being with us. Second hour, we're going to talk about movies a bit because the biggest movie ever in the history of Earth, the probably in the whole galaxy, is opening today. So we'll talk with Stephen Graydonis, the very fine movie critic, about movies for the second hour. This hour, have you ever heard this, maybe from one of your kids or from a relative? I know religion is important to you, but it's just not important to me. That's just not part of my life or my thing or whatnot. We have a growing religious indifferentism or indifference to holy things. What's the cause of that and what do we do about it? If you would like to talk about that, if you have someone in your family who maybe is indifferent, it's not that they don't accept the answers of the church or of Christ himself. They're just not interested in that. And you'd like some help with that, 888-318-7884 is our number, 888-318-7884. Our guest this hour is Matt Nelson, and in addition to being a Canadian, he's also a popular blogger whose work you can read at reasonablecatholic.com, and is the author of a brand new book from Catholic Answers Press, Just Whatever, How to Help the Spiritually Indifferent Find Beliefs That Really Matter. I'm not sure if I pronounced it right. Like, I feel like I should have more of irony in my voice, but I'll work on that. Matt Nelson, welcome. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks very much for having me. It's good to be here.
When I saw that this book was coming out, I thought that is brilliant because often the problem is not that people are rejecting what Christ said or what the church said. It's that they just are indifferent to the other. They don't need that. They don't have a felt need for it.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I'm writing this book from the perspective of somebody who has been on both sides of the fence. When I left home after high school, I went off to university and eventually found myself being one of the spiritual but not religious.
Yeah.
And eventually found my way back. But when I, you know, writing this book, I was able to relate to it, you know, with that unique perspective. But everywhere I go and mention that, you know, up until now, mention that I'm writing this book, it's incredible how many people immediately just respond by saying, this is exactly what we need. And then they start to share their stories.
Yeah, I'm glad that I have found agreement in other people on that, because just as soon as I saw it, I thought, yes, that's what we need to talk to, and we need to somehow find a way to reach people who are not at the moment. I suppose that's one way of thinking about it too. Not at the moment experience any felt need for God. But that doesn't mean that when this moment passes, whether it's this decade or the next decade, that they won't. How do we talk to those folks? 888-318-7884 is the number. And I have to admit, probably the most common request for prayer we get is, can you pray for my children who have left the church? And so if you're a parent who would like to maybe think about getting this book for yourself, to think about that. Or maybe you're one of those young people who has left the church, and for you, just whatever is a perfectly good answer to religion. 888-318-7884. I have to say, Matt, you made a choice in this book that I don't think is immediately obvious as a good choice. And so I want you to justify it to me. No, I mean, I do see, having read some, that it is, but you focus it around the word worship. You have the sections in it, why worship God, why worship Jesus, why worship in the Catholic Church. And I would think worship might be a word that would push people away, but what do you think?
Yeah, well, I think what I wanted to do is take a bold approach. And what we need to do is speak religious language eventually to people to justify religion. And also, because people are expecting us, when they want us to justify what we mean by Catholicism being worthwhile in terms of thinking seriously about it, or eventually moving on to ordering one's life around God. And I think that it's important right away to establish that we're not afraid to try to justify right to the top.
Yeah.
The very central action of religion, which is worship. Obviously, that word is a heavy word when we talk about religion to somebody who's not interested in religion. But I think we can be bold, maybe to wake somebody up initially, and then we take a step back and we listen to what is being said across the table. And then maybe we adapt our language a little bit at that point and work our way back towards language like worship eventually. So we, you know, we can enter into a conversation with that confidence, which can sometimes be appealing in and of itself, to show we're not afraid to take a stab at why it's worthwhile to worship God or worship Christ or worship within a certain church. But now let's step back and let's walk in your door and have a conversation, maybe let you set the tone a little bit.
That's fascinating to me, because just yesterday we did an interview with the great scholar George Weigel, in which he advised us and all of our listeners against the idea of Catholic light, that it has an attraction to present the church in a light way, but that it may not do anybody any good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and that's the thing. Like, we, I think, are running into this issue in many parishes everywhere. Certainly here in Canada, and speaking to friends and family in the States, sounds like the same thing there, where Catholic light, so-called, is becoming so prominent that that's just how people are starting to understand Catholicism. But that's not the sort of religion that ultimately reaches the depths of the human heart and gives people what they're looking for when they're seeking out religion. Yeah, I think you're right that this Catholic light is out there and it's becoming prominent. But I think it's time for people like us to speak confidently about the fullness of Catholicism that we have accepted and that we're excited about, and use that as our starting point.
888-318-7884 is our number if you'd like to speak with our guest this hour, author Matt Nelson, who has just come out with his brand new and fascinating book, Just Whatever: How to Help the Spiritually Indifferent Find Beliefs That Really Matter. When you write a book like this, do you have a person in mind? I mean, our religious landscape is so shattered, and people are coming at it from so many different directions. Do you, as an author, go, here's the person that I'm thinking of as I'm writing this? So you have a kind of a mental audience.
Well, I think so. That was one of the interesting parts of writing this book. This book began to take shape about 3 years ago, and it was supposed to initially be a booklet. But the more that I thought about it and spoke with Todd, the Catholic Answers Press editor, and the more just, you know, prayed and pondered on it deeper, I began to sort of see that it was almost impossible to write a booklet in the way that I wanted to write this. And so religious indifference, generally speaking, is the failure to think seriously about religious questions, and then the failure to give God his due. So there's an intellectual and a practical component. But as I got thinking about it, you know, you look at some of these Pew Forum landscapes, a full quarter of Americans now are unaffiliated with any religion. They self-identify with none whatsoever. So they've been called the nuns, N-O-N-E-S. As opposed to religious nuns and habits. So I definitely had the nuns in mind writing this book. But then I realized indifference also comes in many different forms and comes to different degrees as well. Even reflecting on my own experience, I kind of fluctuated day in and day out from different degrees and, you know, different degrees of indifference. And, you know, one day if you had a conversation with me, I'd sound like a full-blown skeptic, straddling the fence of agnosticism and atheism. And the next day I'd, you know, be defending some Catholic doctrine that I heard misrepresented by somebody. So I broke the book down into three sections, each section sort of giving an outline for an approach we might take apologetics-wise with three different kinds of indifferentists.
888-318-7884 is the number. Just Whatever is the book, how to help the spiritually indifferent find beliefs that really matter. Matt Nelson, the author, he is our guest. We'll be right back with your calls for Matt after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Bishop Robert Barron. You're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite Monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
We live in an age of indifference. Does truth exist? Maybe. Is there a God? Who knows? Does it matter what religion you believe in? Probably not. If you think so, fine. I'm spiritual, but not religious. Apologist Matt Nelson says this indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates our culture. And rather than remain indifferent, he did something about it. In his new book, Just Whatever, Matt looks at the different kinds of indifference you likely encounter in your friends and family members, and maybe in yourself, and offers an antidote to the problem that plagues our age. Order your copy of Just Whatever today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Killett, your host, and it is our great big Friday show, and it really is a great big Friday show. A lot of cool stuff to talk about, a lot of cool people to talk about it with. Matt Nelson is the cool guy we're talking to this hour. Is that that's not a reflection on the fact that you live in Saskatchewan, but are people up there in Canada, are you cool, or are you kind of nerdy?
In the winter months, we're pretty cool.
Yeah, I knew it. I knew you were going there.
yeah, well, you set me up for that one. So.
Just Whatever, How to Help the Spiritually Indifferent Find Beliefs That Really Matter is Matt Nelson's book. And as I was saying to Matt in the first segment, I thought that is a brilliant idea, because some of our problem certainly is that people have the wrong answer about the Catholic Church or about Jesus or about God. But a good deal of our problem is folks just won't get started with questioning. They just don't care. And in your own mind, how much of that has to do with just kind of material well-being? We've got so much stuff. We can kind of tune out pressing questions of meaning.
Well, I think there's lots of factors that could probably be reasonably defended when it comes to religious indifference. But this was something that I went into depth in my book. I think that being distracted by there's just so much out there now to occupy us, and so much out there to encourage us into a life of self-actualization, that we're so focused in on, our social media and social approval, and just getting so sucked into. And I'm a fan of social media. I've got a Facebook and a Twitter account, but I think we're becoming so self-absorbed in many ways because we've been given so many new ways to do so. And on top of that, we carry these smartphones in our pockets, me included. And so we're connected to this social media and these, even our email and Google.
Yeah.
So anytime we have a question, we just go straight to Google. And knowing that we've got this power in our pocket, we start to not only become distracted and occupied with all of these things we've got going on that we're constantly checking in and out of, but we also, I think, can fall to this delusion of self-sufficiency, where religion, which involves us giving ourselves, even surrendering ourselves to somebody else in a radical way, becomes something that's hard for people to rationalize when they feel like they've got all the power they need, you know, right at their fingertips.
Yeah.
And yeah.
It's striking to me that people often say, like about atheism or many things, but let's just use atheism, for example, because it's one of the three things that you kind of, you know, indifference to God is one of the three things you deal with in just whatever, your brand new book. And but you'll hear people say, well, we just know so much more now, and that's why people don't believe in God. But you think, do we know so much more? Because it seems like all this new atheism coincides almost exactly with the period where our education system kind of started to fall apart, and we all decided we're going to watch TV and have social media all the time.
Hmm. Yeah, I think if a new atheist or one of their followers, or anybody for that matter, wants to say that we know so much now that anyone reasonable won't be able to justify being a religious person, I'd like to know what they mean by so what we know exactly. When they say we know so much more, they mean we know so much more in the scientific realm? Do they mean we know so much more philosophically? Mm. I mean, that I think is the first question that we should be asking when a claim like that is made. Because as many of the listeners are going to know, the question of whether God exists and what the nature of God is not ultimately a scientific question. So science can continue to advance, and as the Catholic Church, we'll continue to applaud that because we're on the side of science. But at the same time, if there's, let's say, you know, some kind of an advance philosophically where there's some really good arguments out there, for atheism, well, we should be open to that too. We as Catholics shouldn't be afraid to dive in with anybody who wants to bring arguments against our faith to our attention.
That's an excellent point. I appreciate you saying that because that allows for the dialogue. It allows for the conversation. And that's a good part of what people need. We have a lot of callers on the line, and I've been kind of monopolizing you. Do you mind if we go to a call?
No, let's go for it.
All right, let's go to Robert in Camdenton, Missouri, listening on KHJR Covenant Network. Robert, you are on with Matt Nelson. Your question, please.
Hi, just a question in terms of indifference. Throughout history, I think mankind had the choice, basically, of getting involved in history actively or just like a lot of people, just watching it go by, you know, just kind of like not getting involved in it, weighing up a decision as to whether to enlist in a war or not to enlist in a war. But and finally, too, biblically, I think that when Jesus confronted a mute and someone that was blind and that possibly had very limited possibilities of getting involved in history, and probably more than likely seemed to be the most indifferent people alive. But when Jesus healed them, He gave them a new life. And so, in other words, the difference, the choices we have is to be indifferent or have new life. Could you remark on that, please?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's a good point, Robert. This is one of the things that I speak about probably most directly in the third section of my book. You mentioned that we're being offered as mankind new life in Jesus Christ. As Catholics, we understand that that new life comes to us in a very specific manner, at least normally speaking, and that's through the sacraments. And this is one of the things that I address in the third section of my book, where I address the problem of denominational indifference, which is indifference that exists within Christianity itself, where Christians, and not necessarily non-Catholic Christians, but Christians, whatever their denomination is, are just okay with the splits and the fractures within Christianity today. And so for that reason, they don't go deeper and try to intellectually seek unity with other Christians. And so what I propose in this third section of the book is that the Catholic Church offers something very different from even the Eastern Orthodox, who come very, very close to being in full communion with the Catholic Church. I say we offer these three things. The first is complete unity in truth, that is in the doctrine, because the magisterium keeps us on the right track and protects the purity of the faith that was passed on by the apostles. The second is complete unity in Christ, especially through the Eucharist, but also through the other sacraments. And the third is complete unity through our communion with the saints, not just on earth, but in purgatory and heaven. And I think that what you're saying here is, yeah, we have this opportunity to present people with a profound kind of unity, new life altogether through the sacraments of the Catholic Church. And so why are people indifferent to the sacraments? Well, I think in one sense, I would just say it's probably got to do many times with just the fact that people don't know what a sacrament is and don't understand the full gravity of the Christian life without the sacraments. Does that get anywhere near what you were trying to comment on,
Robert?
Excuse me, just one last question. I just brought this up. You know, indifference is, you know, it's, I don't know, would it be considered a sin? But in a way, there's something really positive about it, because it's kind of a lesser sin than a greater sin is.
I wonder about that, Robert. But immediately when you say that, that makes me think of the image of Christ spitting the lukewarm out of his mouth. You know, that statement, be either hot or cold, but not lukewarm. But Matt, your take.
Yeah, well, I would just say that, I mean, the church has been clear that atheism is potentially considered a sin if somebody has had adequate opportunity to come to knowledge of God and has rejected, number one, that opportunity or that rational capacity to come to know God. And I mean, this is the sort of thing that is rooted right in Paul's letter to the Romans in chapter 1, verse 20, where he says, ever since the beginning of creation, God has revealed himself, his nature, his invisible nature, namely his eternal power and deity in the things that have been made. And so he goes on to say that those in Rome who are falling to grave sins are without excuse. And so there are people on earth that are fully rational and capable of coming to know God through rational theology, through observing the physical world, and at least coming to know something of who God is. And so I think that there is a culpability involved with indifference, where people, especially people of the age of reason, who are capable of coming to know God through what they observe around them, and capable of experiencing God, if God is reaching out to them in some supernatural way, we're still capable of rejecting that. So yeah, I think this is a really good point made by Robert, that indifference is an unfortunate phenomenon, but it could very much be a moral phenomenon as well. We consider it that.
Right, because we have a moral obligation to be fully reasonable and responsible in the choices that we make.
Exactly.
And when we're avoiding that, we're making a very grave choice. Again, 888-318-7884 is the number. Robert, we're going to send you a free copy of Just Whatever. Am I saying that right, or should I give more emphasis on it? Just Whatever. How am I doing?
That sounded good. Oh, I like right. The second one.
We're going to send you a copy of that. Every caller who gets through and is able to talk with Matt today, we're going to send you a free copy of this brand new book. If you'd like to buy the book, if maybe someone in your family is of a just whatever kind of attitude when it comes to God or Jesus or the church, the book is on sale, 15% off right now if you put the promo code SPRING18 in with it. Actually, everything at shop.com, shop.catholic.com is on sale. But also, we're going to give you free shipping on this book for the next few days. Since we've got Matt here with us, we thought we'd send it out to you without any shipping cost if you order it in the next couple days. Just Whatever, How to Help the Spiritually Indifferent Find Beliefs That Really Matter. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. Matt, is a part of this is maybe includes, as you said, being bold. Just be bold in the proclamation of what's available to you in God, in Christ, and in the church. If we go to part two and we talk about Christ, there seems to be this just growing willingness to almost make Christ or Jesus the butt of jokes in our culture, in our shared culture here in America and Canada and in the Western world. How do we get people past that trivializing of the person of Jesus?
Well, I think there's a number of ways to do that. My goal in that second part of the book is to give people some avenues to show them that the person of Jesus Christ needs to be taken seriously, not just in the moral teachings that he handed out, but in the very person that he claimed to be. And so...
Oh, you hear that music, huh? Sorry, I asked you the question. Let me ask you the hardest question I can with 30 seconds to go. Sorry about that, Matt. I wasn't paying attention to the clock. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back. We'll let you answer that, why we should take Jesus seriously. Because that is one of the things that helps cut through that indifference. Just whatever. How to help the spiritually indifferent find beliefs that really matter. Matt Nelson, the author. 888-318-7884. The number. We'll be right back with your calls for Matt after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Encounter with Dan Demite and Patrick Rice is our new radio show for young adults.
The Holy Spirit is about a new and exciting work in the young church of today. On Encounter, we bring young adults the life-changing testimonies of ordinary people that launch them into lives of extraordinary mission. Their testimonies bring faith and power into the lives of everyone who listens.
Encounter with Dan Demite and Patrick Rice. The spiritual awakening continues Saturday night, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Can you trust the basis of the Christian faith? The Christian faith is under constant attack today in numerous ways, but the attack that does the most damage is the one that asks a deceptively simple question. What if your faith is based on a myth? The skeptics come with arguments to cast doubt in numerous ways, often attacking the reliability of the New Testament and the Gospels. And the sad news is that most people don't know how to answer these charges. The good news is that there are answers to each and every one of them. Good, solid answers. That's why Catholic Answers Studios has just released Jimmy Akin's new DVD, The Dawn of Christian History. With his characteristic wit and passion as a master storyteller, Jimmy takes you through an exciting detective story that reveals how history supports the Christian faith. Order your copy of The Dawn of Christian History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Interested in visiting Catholic Answers? If you live in or plan to visit beautiful Southern California, we'd love to have you come by for a tour. You can meet our apologists and staff, visit our chapel, and watch the broadcast of Catholic Answers Live. To arrange a tour, call us at 619-387-7200 or email us at visit@catholic.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. It is Friday, and that means the Great Big Friday Show. Our guest this hour is Matt Nelson, whose brand new book is just out from Catholic Answers Press. Just whatever, how to help the spiritually indifferent find beliefs that really matter. And we're talking a bit about indifference. And the book is broken up into three main sections, Matt. And we talked about the why you use the word worship and about being bold and proclaiming what we believe. And the first part is why worship God. The second part, why worship Jesus. The third part, why worship in the Catholic Church. And so my question to you before the break that I did not give you enough time to answer, and I want to do that before we go back to calls, had to do with how do we get a culture who has trivialized Jesus and people who have grown up in that culture to take Jesus seriously again?
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, I'm going to just step back from the direction I was going before. And the first thing I want to say is, interestingly enough, even though Jesus is being downplayed to something other than God in many cases and seen as a wise teacher or a wise guru of some sort or whatever it whatever the lesser than God title happens to be.
Right.
The interesting thing is Jesus has never fallen out of fashion, not even with the non-Catholic crowds. And actually, in his magisterial book, At the Origins of Atheism, Jesuit scholar Michael Buckley comments on this when he's talking about the Enlightenment and the fact that even though, as a result of the Enlightenment, there was an unprecedented skepticism which started to roll down, you know, towards our modern times now, Jesus was not really slandered during this time in any significant way. He was still recognized as somebody who had much of value to offer mankind in terms of at least his moral teachings. And so it's interesting how Jesus, all through these centuries, especially as Western civilization has become more secularized, has still remained in a sense fashionable, even though he, you know, maybe has been reduced to something other than what he claimed to be.
So you're he is a figure that you'd have to wrestle with then.
Yeah, and okay. Well, and exactly, and that's, but I want to just touch on that quickly, because I think that that then is our entry point for speaking about others to Jesus and getting to them to that point where they can see why we think Jesus is worthy of worship. What we need to do is show them who Jesus claimed to be and show them that we're not left with the option of calling him a wise teacher or a wise prophet. And anybody who's read C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity probably already is recognizing where I'm going with this. C.S. Lewis provides his famous trilemma argument in Mere Christianity, where he says Jesus doesn't leave the option of calling him a good moral teacher or a great prophet because he claimed to be God.
Yeah.
And somebody who claims to be God but is not is either an evil liar trying to deceive the masses, or he's a madman. And when you break it down, neither of those descriptions fit Jesus very well. And so we're left with that third option, which is Jesus was who he said he was.
888-318-7884, 888-318-7884, the number. If you would like to talk with Matt Nelson, author of Just Whatever, the brand new book out from Catholic Answers Press, we go to Francis now in Newton, Iowa, listening on 94.5 FM. Francis, your question for Matt Nelson.
Hello?
Hi, Francis. You are on. You
Hi,
have
Francis.
A question for Matt Nelson?
Oh, okay. Well, thank you for taking my call.
Happy to.
I have a question about worship, because he talked about his book being a lifting up worship as the highest form and the call as Christians.
Okay.
Is that right? Well, my question is that what form of worship then is he calling people to come to? To me, it seems like that it would be the Holy Mass, which is the true worship of the God the Father through Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit within us, and that him lifting up his very body and blood for us is the most glorious worship we can ever do, and that if we somehow find our meaning in life in that, that we have then found our meaning in life. And my point is that I have found that in my life, going to Mass for the last 45 years of my life, used in the ordinary form, it's actually taken me away from what real worship is. I was a little boy at 7 years old when the Latin Mass came English. And I remember at 7 years old, my father on his knees for almost the full hour at Mass. And he never sang anywhere else except at Mass. And I remember him singing the Sanctus as a little tiny boy. You know, just Sanctus.
So, Francis, I'm gathering what you're saying. Let me just see if I can encapsulate it for you, and we can form it in the form of a question for Matt. But it strikes me that Matt is saying we should be bold in inviting people to worship. Worship God, worship Jesus, and worship within the Catholic Church. And correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems to me you're saying what we need to be even more specific in the call and call people to worship in the what's now called the extraordinary form, the Latin Mass. Is that the point that you're making, Francis?
Well, I would say this, that the extraordinary form of the Latin Mass, it is absolute worship with a sideline of a little bit of instruction. What I find in the ordinary form is it is all catechetical instruction with a little sideline of worship.
Okay, Matt, what do you make of that? Because you do make a very bold call that people should be worshiping within the Catholic Church.
Yeah, and I would say that that's primarily because it's in the Catholic Church where these three forms of complete unity are offered, but especially unity in Christ, both physically and spiritually through the Eucharist in the Holy Mass. But I'm interested to know from Francis. Francis, do you believe that whether a Catholic worships in the ordinary form or the extraordinary form of the Mass, receiving the Eucharist and participating in the sacraments in the state of grace, do you believe that there's an advantage to being saved ultimately by worshiping in one form versus the other?
Oh, Francis, I apologize.
I'm not an Adventist or anything like that. I believe that Jesus really is present. It is really the sacrifice of the Mass. But how we do it makes a difference. How yeah. we worship. Do we face in one direction and worship God, or do we face each other and worship each other?
Okay, Matt?
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think that I'm the right person to get too far in depth in comparing and contrasting these two forms of worship. But what I would say is, ultimately, I think reading the lives of the saints, reading the catechism, the scriptures, we can conclude that the posture of the heart ultimately is going to be what trumps everything else. Now, it is important, obviously, to follow our conscience and our reason. And if we know the Catholic Church to be the true church Jesus founded, and we know the Eucharist to be what it truly is, then we have a moral obligation to be there and to participate in the ways that the church has prescribed as appropriate. But I think that's where I would depart on this one, is I would just say that as far as pitting up one form of worship versus the other within the acceptable forms of worship in the Catholic Church, that's something I would stay away from personally, just because my area of specialty is to focus on religious indifference, not so much which way we're worshiping within the Catholic Church. But I think that the extraordinary form of the Mass is a beautiful way to worship. And although I would disagree, and I'm not saying that this is what you're asserting, but I would disagree that one form over the other is going to, put someone on a better trajectory towards
holiness,
the pearly gates of heaven. I think that that might be a stretch,
Is, it's wonderful to see that the extraordinary form is very appealing to many young people, and the ordinary form is very appealing to others, and myself, I'm probably one of the school of thought that's like, whatever you're wearing, whatever you're, wherever you're coming from, wherever you're going to, if you're coming to Mass, then I'm so happy that you're there. And I feel like we just need to get these young people to come, because they will find there the Lord. He's waiting for them there.
Yeah. C.S. Lewis actually talks about this in the Screwtape Letters. And one of the things that Lewis claims through his dialogue there is that the devil is trying to make us become indifferent towards our bodily postures when we worship. I think that this is an important conversation to have, and Francis is somebody that I would want to have that conversation with once, my relationship with him was at a point where we were both in the Catholic Church, we were, committed to the church as Catholics, and we were at a point where it's appropriate to be speaking about that sort of fine-tuning of the ways we worship. But at the same time, we're living in the time of the nuns, which is the fastest growing religious demographic in the United States. And in Canada, it's very similar statistically. So if we've got somebody who is maybe for the first time ever, or maybe for the first time in a long time, gracing the doors of a parish, or even just entering into a religious conversation, and somehow we get tied up in these sort of secondary issues, because they're not necessarily secondary issues down the road, but at that point in the dialogue, they are. We can put people off right away. You know, so I think we just have to be prudent.
Yeah, as someone who has put people off right away, I completely agree with you. The fact is, right, with the reason we want people to receive the Eucharist is that Christ is there. The reason we want them to receive Christ is God, and He loves them. The reason we want them to believe in God is because there's nothing more important, that we have to help people through. And I think you and I probably are both of the same experience, that someone had to help us, or a whole variety of people had to help us through the steps to finally come to the point where you just kind of, you surrender and say, yeah, there you are in the Eucharist. This is your church. This is my home. Matt Nelson is our guest. Just Whatever is the book. We're working through helping those who are spiritually indifferent to find God, to find Christ, to find the church. We'll be right back to do more of that with your calls for Matt on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, my friends. This is Christopher Check, president of Catholic Answers. I'm sure you have heard that it's still okay these days to hold to the quaint superstitions of Catholicism as long as you leave them in church, because when it comes to reality, religion is just foolishness that withers in the fierce light of science. Problem is, this narrative is false. It is in the Christian West that scientific discovery has most flourished. Still, too many of us find ourselves flat-footed when confronted with bugbears like Adam and Eve versus evolution, creation versus Big Bang, and Galileo versus the Inquisition. What can you do? Come to Catholic Answers' 5th National Conference, Faith and Science. Guest speakers Father Terry Ehrman and Dr. Stacy Trasankos will join the whole Catholic Answers team to explain how faith and science are actually in harmony. September 27 to 30, right here in San Diego. And we are thrilled to announce a special keynote address by Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke honoring the 50th anniversary of Humanae Vitae. For all the details, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com.
We live in an age of indifference. Does truth exist? Maybe. Is there a God? Who knows? Does it matter what religion you believe in? Probably not. If you think so, fine. I'm spiritual, but not religious. Apologist Matt Nelson says this indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates our culture. And rather than remain indifferent, he did something about it. In his new book, Just Whatever, Matt looks at the different kinds of indifference you likely encounter in your friends and family members, and maybe in yourself, and offers an antidote to the problem that plagues our age. Order your copy of Just Whatever today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question. 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and we're talking with the author of Just Whatever. And whatever, man, that is a powerful dismissal. That is a powerfully dismissive word that has become part of everyday life in our culture. Just whatever, how to help the spiritually indifferent find beliefs that really matter. We're giving it away free to everybody who gets through to talk with Matt today. Probably actually everybody who, you know, makes it through the phone lines is probably going to end up getting one. But we'll promise it to everybody who gets through to talk with Matt. If you have a question about maybe someone in your life is expressing this kind of religious indifference, maybe you feel it yourself, it's just hard to care about all that religious stuff, give us a call, 888-318-7884. We go now to Grace in Rochester, New York, listening on 92.9 FM. Grace, you're on with Matt Nelson. Your question, please.
Hi there. Hopefully you can hear me clearly.
If we
it's
can.
Just getting a little tough, but I have two questions. The first one is, when talking with people who don't believe or atheists in general, I guess we oftentimes say you should read the Bible. My question is, I guess one point that atheists bring up is that, like, we point them to the Bible and say it's inerrant, and in saying it's inerrant, we cite the Bible and say, like, read the Bible to show its inerrancy. And yeah, they ask for, like, outside sources to support the Bible's truth. So, like, how do you get around that?
Okay. Well, there's different approaches that you can take with this. This is a great question, by the way, Grace. And it's something that I had a lot of fun researching it during my intellectual conversion. Like I mentioned, at the age of 25, I kind of had this emotional conversion where I knew that God existed and that something was in the Catholic Church that I needed to be a part of. But my intellectual conversion took a lot longer, and I had to ask these questions about the Bible, because not only were skeptics providing arguments for why we shouldn't trust the Bible, but then obviously, Protestant Christians see the Bible as the sole rule of faith. And so there was different perspectives that I needed to really come to unpack the scriptures from. And one of the things that really impressed me was the number of manuscripts that exist today that help us to confirm that what is in the scriptures now is what was originally written. We have over 5,000, in fact, over 5,500 Greek manuscripts and fragments of manuscripts today of the New Testament. That's just in the Greek, and most of the New Testament was written in the Greek. So obviously that is pretty key. The earliest intact, like full scriptures that we've got as far as manuscripts go are from the 4th century, from the Codex Vaticanus and the Codex Sinaiticus. So speaking from the perspective of ancient history, ancient historians think they've hit pay dirt with these sorts of manuscripts, and they're able to verify that what we read in our RSV or our NAB or whatever translation of Bible we have today is what was originally written by Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, James, and so forth. So I think like that's one place we can start, just by saying, from the perspective of standards that ancient historians put out there for how can we know that what's in the Bible today is authentic, well, that's one starting point, is we just have a lot of manuscript evidence. That's just Greek manuscripts. Then we've got like over, I think it's over 20,000 manuscripts in other languages like Latin and Syriac and other languages. So there's lots of manuscript evidence. But also, New Testament studies has come a long way in recent years. In the mid-1990s, a New Testament scholar named Richard Burridge came out with a book that really changed the opinions of a lot of New Testament scholars at the time. His book was called What Are the Gospels? And he was to make a really compelling case for the Gospels as Greco-Roman biography, which means that what Matthew, Mark, and Luke and John were trying to do when they wrote their Gospels was record the life of a real individual and provide facts and sayings that really occurred in the first century Palestine. So scholarly evidence has come, or scholarly opinion has come a long way to where even critical scholars today will agree, in fact, almost unanimously across the board, both Christian and non-Christian scholars, including the most skeptical ones, and there's actually quite a few atheist and agnostic New Testament scholars out there today. There's a number of facts that New Testament scholars almost unanimously agree on. One of those is the crucifixion of Christ. So forget about the existence of Christ. That's something that almost nobody has argued for a long time. Not only the New Testament scholars, and the majority of them accept his existence, they accept his crucifixion. They also accept other minimal facts like his burial in the tomb, and then several other facts, which I go into depth in the book. The third thing that I would offer you, Grace, is to get to know the arguments for the resurrection of Christ. Because the New Testament is essentially the good news of Jesus Christ, and it announces the victory of God over death and over sin. And so how did he do that? Well, he died on the cross and he rose from the dead. If we can show that there's a compelling case for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and if we can do it in a non-biblical way, meaning if we can do it in, say, a historical and a rational way, then we can show that the church he founded, therefore, would have their hands on scriptures and on a tradition that we could accept as inerrant and when it comes to the scriptures, God breathed. So the book that I would recommend to you without hesitation when it comes to the historical and logical defense of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is a book by two evangelical scholars, Michael Lycona and Gary Habermas. They wrote a book called, which was kind of a popular compilation of many years of intense study, especially by Gary Habermas. And the book is called The Resurrection of the Case for the Resurrection of Jesus. And that is one of the most like mind-blowing books that I've read since I've come back to the Catholic Church when it comes to making a case for not just the existence of Christ, not just his crucifixion on the cross, but for his resurrection from the dead.
Grace, I hope that that is helpful. You're going to get a free copy of Matt's new book, and I'm only moving on because I have not been good about letting people get through to talk with Matt, so I'm going to try to get to as many questions as I can. Thanks, Grace. We go now to Kurt in Janesville, Wisconsin, listening on EWTN. Kurt, your question for Matt Nelson.
Hello. My question is, I have indifferent people, whatever people in my family, and I've been told that you could witness to them, and I have, bring them to Mass, pray for them, but they just are whatever, continue to be that way. Is there anything else you could do?
Well, it sounds like you've got things in the right order. Let me sympathize with you as well. I think for a lot of people, I was a kind of a hopeless cause maybe at one point. And luckily, I was one of those young people that comes out of it pretty early in life. I know that that's not the norm necessarily. I've got people in my own family who are far from the church and raised in the church. And you know, I have a lot of answers, but I haven't been able to, as far as I can tell, budge them from their indifferent or rather skeptical position. So I can sympathize with you. And I think you've got it right that we need to remember spiritually as Christians that we need to not put the burden of the conversion of others completely on our shoulders. We need to carry out our mission as Christians. The church is a mission, as many of the popes have said, especially in modern times. The church is a mission, which makes us all missionaries by virtue of our baptism. And so, you know, we feel the obligation to find a way to reach these people in our lives. And I would say the hardest people to reach are the people closest to us in many cases. You've prayed for them. Have you had many conversations with these people where you've sat back and allowed them to share with you very boldly on their behalf why they hold the beliefs they have?
Probably not enough. That's a good point.
Okay. So that's another step you can take. And
so,
I think
Matt, just to clarify, so are you like saying just ask questions or what exactly are you recommending there?
Okay. One of the tendencies we get when we get into the apologetics scene and we start to digest all this information, get excited about all the reasons to believe, is we just want to share it all right away. But on the other side of it, when we speak to other people about their doubts or their hesitations, a lot of times they're not ready to hear anything you have to say, except tell me how you feel about the Catholic Church, for example, or tell me how you feel about this, the idea of God. So what I'm saying is, this is a key entry point. Ask people what they think about our faith, or about some specific tenet of the faith or of belief that can be a starting point. Just want to throw this out there, and then I'd like to hear more from
Kurt.
Yeah. When I was thinking about what kind of approach can we take with the nuns or with the indifferent, I thought, who are the people? Because religion is kind of one of those things people just don't want to talk about, period. And they get weird about it sometimes as soon as you bring it up, so you can't even have a serious conversation. So I thought to myself, like, who are the people out there that are having conversations with people on the most sensitive topics imaginable? And I thought of the pro-life movement. And I live in Canada, so this is the home of CCBR with Stephanie Gray and other great pro-life apologists. And one of the things that they do is they stand on a street corner with their pamphlets or whatever they have, and the first thing they say to anyone who walks by is just, what do you think about abortion? And that gets the thing off the ground.
We're not going to be able to go back to Kurt because we've come to the end of the hour. But so you could say to someone, what do you think about the Catholic Church?
Or what do you think about religion? And then find out where to start from there.
Yeah. Matt Nelson, thanks so much for the hour. Really enjoyed it. Just Whatever, How to Help the Spiritually Indifferent Find Beliefs That Really Matter. You can get it at shop.catholic.com. Just Whatever. Thanks, Matt.
Thank you very much.
Let's do it again sometime. You can also find Matt at reasonablecatholic.com. We'll be right back with Stephen Gray Donis and movies after this.
This is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Thank you for listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Just like the saints of the Counter-Reformation, our own souls are in constant need of reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. We struggle with sin. We become distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. In Reform Yourself, Sean McAfee shows you how these magnificent saints can be guides to your own personal transformation. We all need to reform our souls. Let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
This year's Catholic Answers National Apologetics Conference is proud to announce our very special keynote speaker, Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke. Do you have your tickets? Early bird pricing ends July 2nd. Seats are still available, but they're going fast. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today to register.
God helps those who help themselves. Preach the gospel always. When necessary, use words. Sayings like these are such a part of tradition that we assume they come from the Bible, the saints, or famous Christian writers, even though nobody can seem to place their origin. By sheer repetition, they have acquired a halo of truth. In What the Saints Never Said, Trent Horn takes over 40 of these well-known but actual dubious sayings and attempts to track them to their true source. The result? He finds some that are close to what was really said, many that were misattributed or twisted beyond their original meaning, and more than a few that were just plain made up. By setting the record straight, Trent roots out theological errors that can lead us away from Christian truth and offers authentic quotes from scripture, saints, and scholars that will draw you closer to that truth. Get your copy of What the Saints Never Said today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Do you enjoy tedious lectures full of facts you'll never use? We didn't think so. That's why we're launching the Council of Trent, Trent Horn's engaging new podcast. Every week, you'll get lively lessons in Catholic teaching, as well as a new conversation roadmap that will help you share your Catholic faith with anyone, anytime, anywhere. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com now to find out how you can subscribe to this exciting new podcast.
Would you like to become a Catholic Answers Live parish partner? We need you to help us spread the word at your local parish. We'll give you bumper stickers, window clings, flyers, everything you need to let your parish know about the best Catholic radio show on the air. We want you to partner with us. Email us at calpartners@catholic.com today and become a Catholic Answers parish partner.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out,
because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Killett, your host, and the most important movie ever released in the history of the world starts its run this weekend, and it's almost certain to remain atop the box office until next month's most important movie in the history of the world comes out. I'm speaking, of course, of The Avengers Infinity War, which, if you think about it, will be a screaming disappointment if it grosses less than $1.5 billion or so. I mention all this because we close this work week with a discussion of movies. I am your host, Cy Kellett, as I said, and you, if you would like to be part of the conversation, give us a call, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Our guest this hour is Deacon Stephen Gradonis, the creator of DecentFilms.com and the film critic for the National Catholic Register. He's also a member of the New York Film Critics Circle and a permanent deacon in the Catholic Archdiocese of Newark. Deacon Stephen Gradonis, thanks for being with us.
Sorry, it's great to be here.
So, Infinity War, it's got the word infinity right in it, so you know it's going to be big. Have you seen it?
I have, and you're certainly right. It's going to be huge. We are living in the age of the superhero blockbuster, and 10 years of Marvel dominance in the marketplace has brought us to this moment. This movie has the Avengers. It has the Guardians of the Galaxy. It has Doctor Strange. It has Spider-Man. Literally everyone you know is going to see this movie.
Yeah, literally. But, okay, so as you said, we live now in the age of the superhero movie blockbuster. DC is making them, and we get an occasional Warner Bros. Or somebody makes the monster movies there. I don't know, but is this a good thing that we're living in this age? Are these good, healthy entertainment, or what do you make of it?
You know, I think it's mixed, and it's going to depend to a certain extent on what different filmmakers bring to the party. Take Scott Derrickson, the director of Doctor Strange, which is one of my favorite Marvel movies in recent years. He is an evangelical Christian, and he brought a certain spiritual curiosity to this movie. He explores the idea that reality is much more complicated than what we can see through the lens of science, for instance. So materialistic reductionism, the idea that we're just matter and nothing more, that's not what we see in this movie. Or Black Panther, one of the biggest movies of last year and still in theaters now, raking in money. This is a movie that explores moral themes around racial justice and national responsibility that resonated with a lot of people. So Avengers Infinity War, one way to look at it is through the lens of the ideology of the villain Thanos, who views the world through the lens of a Malthusian worldview. He sees the universe as overpopulated and threatened by too many people, and he wants to wipe out half of the population everywhere in existence for the well-being of the other half. This is obviously a culture of death worldview that's contrary to our Catholic beliefs.
So this guy Thanos, who's this great villain. He's apparently read The Population Bomb.
Remember
the book by Paul Ehrlich?
Ehrlich.
It's been debunked so many times, but people still believe the world is overpopulated. And it's going to be.
Paul Ehrlich still believes it.
I know, poor Paul Ehrlich. It doesn't matter how many things he gets wrong, he insists that they're right or they're about to be right. The great panic of the late 60s, early 70s about overpopulation that never came to pass. I like this, that the villain believes this kind of artifact of history idea that the world is overpopulated. There's too many people. And so his solution is what? He's gonna kill half of them?
Right. So these movies for the last like 6 years, at least since the original Avengers in 2012, written and directed by Joss Whedon, have revolved around these powerful artifacts in the Marvel Universe called Infinity Stones. And each of them by themselves is really powerful. The Tesseract Cube is one. That Stone of the Vision's forehead is one. Doctor Strange's amulet that he uses to manipulate time is one. But it turns out that if you collect all six, you can construct something called the Infinity Gauntlet. And if you have that, you're basically omnipotent and you can do whatever you want. And that's what Thanos wants to do. And he doesn't want to rule the galaxy or destroy the galaxy like other villains. He just wants to wipe out half of all life. And his own daughter, not his real daughter, but the woman that he raised as his daughter, Gamora, who's played by Zoe Saldana, who's one of the Guardians of the Galaxy, she lived on a planet whose people were poor, and Thanos says that he saved her by killing her people and rescuing her. But she says even though they were poor, they were happy. And so there's a little tiny bit of an answer here to that kind of population bomb Malthusian worldview. To me, it's not nearly enough. So in spite of all the nice things that we've been saying about it, I found Avengers Infinity War really wanting on many levels. But I do appreciate these little glimpses of something that could have been a much stronger pro-life message.
Okay, so that's fascinating, I'm glad to hear that. I'm going to share something with you, too, that just before we move on from the population bomb. Did you know that a few years ago, the New York Times reviewed their own journalism about overpopulation in the 60s and 70s and said they had gotten it wrong? I felt really good for them doing that. That's great to hear.
One of the best and most winsome things that you can find on any worldview and any angle of political ideology is the capacity for honest self-criticism. When someone can look at their own intellectual history and their own statements and say, we got this wrong, that's a sign that they're, you know, not as far from the kingdom as they could be.
Amen, brother. So if you've given us then the kind of positive side of these massive superhero movies, that they can, especially in the hands of the right director, they can give us a window on a world of high morals, actually, and of openness to goodness and holy things. What's the other side of the story about these big, giant movies?
So they can also just focus our attention on disaster and spectacle and violence and nihilism. And in the case of Infinity War, you've got a movie from the writer-director team of Civil War and some earlier Marvel movies, Anthony and Joe Russo, and the screenwriters Stephen McFeely and Christopher Marcus. And I don't think that these guys are interested in asking the really deep questions in the way that they could be. So you've got a movie that's got lots and lots of action and noise and violence and a huge body count in the service of much less substance than it could possibly be. And in the end, I feel frustrated by the movie because it does the same thing that all the other Marvel movies have done, which is it gives you this big effect by writing a check that the next movie has to pay. These movies don't ever resolve. They don't ever come to a conclusion. And this one is no different. So people are going to leave the theater feeling like their minds are blown, but it's all just an ad to get you to the theaters to watch the next one.
Which has a certain kind of genius to it, but as a marketing ploy, but is artistically unsatisfying. I was reading you kind of compared it to the Mission Impossible movies, where it's also a big, huge, giant franchise, Mission Impossible, but each story ends. It comes to an end.
I in this day and age, I really appreciate that. It's one thing on television to constantly be raising questions that are never quite answered. Joss Whedon has talked about that. He's worked in television and in movies. It's another thing when you're going to the theater once every few months and you're plunking down your $10, your $12 to sit there for 2.5, close to 3 hours. You want to walk out with questions having been answered, and Marvel isn't delivering that, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's like Moby Dick or the great literature. It doesn't end with a cliffhanger for the next installment in the franchise. There's a kind of violation of the basic principle of storytelling there, where you're insisting, no, this story just goes on and on and on and on.
I think so. It's something that works on the small screen. It's something that movies used to do in like serials, like half hour serials. Like you would go to the theater every Saturday in the 40s and, you know, Zorro or Batman would have another half hour adventure. But then, you know, you come back the next Saturday for the next installment. It was like television.
Yeah.
When you're talking about feature films, there's a different expectation. And Marvel, I think, really is doing something that I personally find fundamentally unsatisfying. Lots of people obviously feel different.
888-318-7884 is the number. We got more movies to talk about, but I did want to take some time to talk about Avengers Infinity War and this whole superhero genre with Stephen Gradonis, the very fine movie critic for the National Catholic Register and as we said before, a member of the New York Film Critics Circle. 888-318-7884, that number. How much, I wonder, Deacon, are we... is just the basic aesthetic principle that a thing is to be beautiful is violated in modern movie making, that we've replaced the idea of beauty or the seeking after beauty with the idea of it's more of a roller coaster ride? Or is that not an important concern, because roller coasters are good too?
I think here of a great line from Pope Pius XII in a document that I love. It's very dear to my heart. It's a pair of addresses that he gave in 1955 to the Italian film industry, his addresses on the ideal film. If you Google ideal film Pius XII, it'll come right up. And he talks about how one of the things that movies can do is just give people who are worn out and tired at the end of a hard day something to relax with, and just a diversion and entertainment. And he says there's nothing wrong with that, and he has this line that he loved. He says, because man has shallows as well as depths.
Oh wow, what a great line.
He goes on, of course, to say, dull, however, is the man who cannot add depth to his thoughts and so forth. But we don't have to be deep and meaningful all the time. It's okay just to watch something that's, you know, flash and sparkle and boom and laughter. Just relax and enjoy yourself. That's okay.
Go ahead.
But then there is this question of, is it too much? Or do we get to the point where we're no longer able to transcend that shallowness and go out into the depths? Are we bored by a movie that wants to challenge us to think, that asks us to stay with an idea, or that doesn't, you know, hang explosions and shiny things in front of us every 5 minutes?
Right. I have to say, at least one thing you can say about the movies too, at least it's still a social experience. So much of our media experiences are antisocial now. But I am being unfair to the callers, because there's a lot of people who have called and want to talk with you. And we got to take a break, and then we're going to come back and take these calls. 888-318-7884 is the number. Deacon Stephen Gradonis is our guest. We're talking movies. We'll be right back with that after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Bishop James Wall from the Diocese of Gallup, New Mexico. Keep it right here on Catholic Answers Live.
What difference does it make who or what you worship or what you believe? Sharing the faith used to make some people mad because it challenged their own strong beliefs. Today, it makes a lot of people yawn because they don't have strong beliefs about anything. Religious indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates modern culture. This is Matt Nelson, and in my new book, Just Whatever, I'll take down the building blocks of religious indifference one by one. We'll look at the different kinds of indifference you tend to encounter in your friends and family members to see where they come from and why they're seductive. What you believe matters. Find out why and what to do about it in my new book, Just Whatever. You can order your copy of Just Whatever by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to the great big Friday show here on Catholic Answers Live. And we're talking with Deacon Stephen Gradonis about movies. And if you have questions or comments, or would like to discuss movies with a man who is both prepared theologically and in terms of his appreciation and understanding of media, Deacon Stephen Gradonis is the perfect guy to talk with. 888-318-7884, the number. And I'll remind you, you can read his reviews at the National Catholic Register, 888-318-7884, the number here. Let's go to another Stephen. Stephen in East Jordan, Michigan, listening on 90.9 FM. You are on with Deacon Stephen Gradonis. Your question, please.
Hello, Deacon. Thanks for taking my call. I just tuned into the show about 10 minutes ago. I just wanted to call and express I was very dissatisfied with the new Star Trek series. I know it wasn't a movie per se, but many of these series, you know, are kind of like just 10 episodes or more, nothing more than a big long movie. But it was unprecedented for Star Trek in their new series where you had to stream it to watch it, which was new. Mm-hmm. And then they had, you know, homosexuality, like, front and center and glamorized and really focused in on in the series. But
so let me just get this straight, Stephen. This is Star Trek Discovery, the new one where you got to get CBS's, like, online service in order to watch it.
I actually signed up for the online service and I watched the first two episodes, and ever since then I've just been paying that monthly bill and not catching up. I keep meaning to catch up with it, but I just haven't had the time.
That you are the perfect customer for CBS.
Am I not?
They must love that. Okay, so Stephen, your question for Deacon Gradonis about the show, though.
Okay, I guess how much more as Catholics do we tolerate before we just don't tune in? It's more and more prevalent every movie I watch anymore.
Right. Wonderful question, sure. Stephen. Great question. Thank you. Deacon Gradonis.
It is a really great question, and I have written specifically about Star Trek in connection with religious and moral issues, in connection with the worldview of the series at Decent Films, and I would recommend those articles to you. You know, Star Trek was founded from the beginning on the vision of Gene Roddenberry, which was a secular, humanist, progressive vision of the future. There are aspects of his vision that I admire and that I like very much, and there are obviously aspects of it that I have a big problem with as a Catholic. On the one hand, for instance, he showed the world in the 1960s a world in which you could have a white male captain on the bridge of a ship with a black female officer, you know, right next to him, a young Chinese officer, a Russian ensign. This was very challenging and interesting at the time. And, you know, there are other interesting and positive aspects of the moral worldview at work in Star Trek, but there are also negative aspects. Religion has always been viewed with skepticism and often with outright dismissal and rejection on Star Trek. Not always. Star Trek's engagement with religion has been mixed, and at times it's been treated with much more respect as part of the human experience. In particular, the Star Trek series Deep Space Nine dealt with religion in some very interesting, complicated ways. With regard to homosexuality, of course, we are living in a world in which which whatever is your sexual orientation is considered to be part of fundamentally who you are. That's the mainstream ideology now, and that's going to be reflected more and more in the entertainment that we imbibe. So we have to be aware of the fact that as Catholics, we hold a worldview that is in some ways at odds with the world in which we live. And so there are always going to be tensions between us and the people around us and the mainstream culture around us. So when you watch a movie or a television show where you're going to see some things that you agree with and some things that you disagree with, you're going to have to make a calculation. You're going to have to ask yourself, first of all, not, you know, is this absolutely pure and perfect and there's nothing in it that I take any exception to? That's a standard that's just not going to work in any area of life. You know, if you insist on having perfect friends and only going to a perfect church where you never hear anything you disagree with and only eating perfect food or drinking perfectly pure water with no impurities or anything that could possibly be bad for you, you're going to die unchurched and friendless and quickly. On the other hand, there are foods and churches and friends who are going to do you more harm than good.
Yeah.
So you need to look at each of these things on a case-by-case basis and say to yourself, what is the overall message here? Is this overall something in which I find positive value, or is this overall something that's kind of confronting me and that's contradicting my faith? And you need to avoid the two extremes of, on the one hand, just accepting everything and saying, oh, it doesn't affect me, I know what I believe, and so I can just watch absolutely everything and there's no moral problems here at all. And then on the other hand, of just rejecting everything that's not totally aligned with our belief as Catholics.
Stephen in Michigan, how does that answer strike you?
Thank you.
Oh, okay. Thanks. Can I piggyback?
You're welcome.
I want to piggyback on Stephen's question a little bit, Deacon. Not to be obnoxious, but I don't want anybody to call you. I just want to talk to you myself the whole hour. But it strikes me that that the answer gets even more complicated when we're paying for things. Like and please correct me if you think I'm a nut, but well, I am a lot of times a nut. But I think paying for services myself, like HBO, for example, that mm-hmm. that produce wonderful content but also produce what's essentially pornography is wrong, that you shouldn't do that. Correct me please if you think I'm being too blanket in my judgment.
So the question of boycotting services when you perceive that there are problematic aspects to it, and then to some extent, you're supporting things that we disagree with, is governed in Catholic moral theology by a principle called the law of double effect. This is when you're doing something that's not intrinsically wrong and it has consequences downstream that are both positive and negative. And so the principles governing this have to do with, first of all, the proportionality of the harm that's caused to the good that's caused, and the immediacy of the effects. In other words, am I doing something that's having immediate bad effects and good effects further downstream, or first that come the good effects and the bad effects are downstream? And the proportionality of the good and the bad. How does the good weigh compared to the bad? There's no way that I can give you a blanket answer on something like subscribing to HBO. I can point out that absolutely everything that we do in life, and especially in our corporate world, every time you go to the store and buy a product, a branded product, you're buying something that's advertised on a particular network. And that network has a particular editorial policy. And they're going to be supporting and giving money, donating to some good causes and some bad causes. You know, it would practically be impossible to go to the store and come home with your groceries and not wind up buying something that in some way could be traced to a company that's going to be donating money to Planned Parenthood. I'm not saying you should never boycott anything, not by any means, but we need to recognize that all of our actions have good consequences and bad consequences, and so we really need to decide these things on a case-by-case basis in terms of the overall good effect and the bad effect. For me, one of my fundamental outlooks when I look at the question of buying a ticket for a movie, you know, people say to me, well, you know, how can you support a movie like Queen of Katwe when it's distributed by Disney and Disney supports these bad things?
Oh, yeah, okay.
You know, my answer to that is, if we don't support good movies, then we're going to just get bad movies. And I think that good movies do more good for the culture than, you know, the idea that we might get another movie like Queen of Katwe.
Yeah.
I think that's a better thing than the fact that, you know, pennies from my – and, you know, we're supporting the people who work in our local theater, and we're supporting other people who are working and doing honest work for a living. Some pennies of that are going to wind up being donated to Planned Parenthood. It's true. But I think that that's sufficiently remote effect that from the principle of double effect, I would say it's justified.
Oh, very fascinating. How bad would you feel about a person if they had only just in the last few minutes heard of the Queen of Katwe? Like if that person had not heard of it, would you feel bad about that person?
No, because I'm thrilled for the opportunity to be able to bring this great movie to people's attention. You know, the star of the movie, David Oyelowo, is a devout Christian, and he put Christian themes into the movie. I reviewed it on Decent Films. It was one of my top 10 films in the year that it was released. And if somebody hasn't heard of Queen of Katwe, then mission accomplished. They've heard of it now.
All right. I'm not going to name who that person is, but it was a hypothetical. If there was a person who had not heard of it. Deacon Stephen Graydonis is our guest. He is a member of the New York Film Critics Circle. He's a permanent deacon of the Catholic Archdiocese of Newark, and he is the film reviewer for the National Catholic Register. We're talking movies, and there are more movies to talk about. There's a whole bunch of interesting things. The Devil and Father Amorth, A Quiet Place, we want to talk about that. Paul, Apostle of Christ. We'll get to that and your calls right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
We're ready and waiting for your call today on Catholic Answers Live.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
As the legend goes, the Protestant Reformation began when Martin Luther nailed the list of his grievances with the Catholic Church to the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg, Germany. But do you know the whole story? In Catholic Answers' brand new documentary, The Protestant Revolution, you will hear from top apologists Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Carla Broussard, Trent Horn, and Steve Weidenkopf as they expose the errors of Martin Luther and of the other so-called reformers. This DVD will give you a clearer understanding of our Protestant brothers and sisters, and you will be better equipped to engage them about what separates us and about what unites us. Order your copy of The Protestant Revolution today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting shop.catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
What's stopping you from becoming a Catholic?
Why can't women become priests?
I don't understand why I have to earn salvation.
How is it possible that God created everything?
Why do I need to confess my sins to a priest?
Why is the Catholic Church so unwilling to
The Catholic Church is too rich.
Catholics worship Mary and are
committed. As far as I'm concerned, all religions are equal.
You are called to communion with Dr. David Anders. Tonight, 11 p.m. Eastern, on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're talking movies with Deacon Stephen Gradonis, movie critic, and very helpful in helping us think through the moral considerations of our media consumption. 888-318-7884 is the number. I have not been good about getting to call, so I'm going to go to Jessica in Modesto, California, listening on to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. Jessica, you're on with Deacon Stephen Gradonis. Your question, please.
Hi, Deacon. Can you hear me?
Yes, Jessica. What's up?
Okay, so I have been listening to you for many years, and I go back and forth. I usually agree with you, but I was glad to hear you say that you were happy that the New York Times was rescinding something that they had said. I wanted to give you a chance to do the same about Coco. Coco
okay.
is the best, and I've watched it a billion times, and I can't get enough of it, and I think it's so good and so moving for kids, and it's just so much like deeper than so many animated films, and just wanted to give you a chance to to fix that.
Okay so here's what I'm prepared to say about Coco. First of all, as a film critic, I want to make absolutely clear, I'm not here to tell anyone what to think. I don't want anyone to agree with every review that I write or everything that I say. I'm here to offer you what I think are some important facts and to give you some perspective on those facts, to give you an informed and responsible construal of those facts. Of course, I think I'm right about absolutely every movie, but it's okay to disagree with me. I'm not the Pope of movies. There is no Pope of movies. Even the Pope isn't the Pope of movies. And I do make mistakes from time to time. I think that I was unfair to Moana, for instance. I gave that movie, I think, a C+ at the time. And after watching it more than once, I'm inclined to think that I judged it too harshly. On the other hand, sometimes I like movies too much, and I realize later that they aren't as good as I thought. The Star Wars prequels are an example of that. Loved them, and it took me years to realize their shortcomings. So is it possible that I'm wrong about Coco? Yes, it is, but I don't think so. So first of all, let me just say there are things about Coco that I love. I love its celebration of Mexican and Latin American culture. I love the music. I love the visuals. I love its emphasis on family. I love the way that it celebrates extended family and honoring and valuing the elderly. So Miguel's great-grandmother, Mama Coco, there's a great line where he says in the beginning when he's introducing his family, she has trouble remembering things, but it's good to talk to her anyway. And that is more than just a heartwarming line. There's this emphasis in the film on emotional connections with the elderly and on remembering those who have gone before and those that we've lost. There are also very moving themes in the film having to do with the relationship between memory and music. Many things about the film that I love, and I understand why people love it. As a Catholic, I am put off not by the imaginative portrayal of the world of the dead, that you die and you go not to heaven or hell or purgatory, but you go to a land where people are walking around as animated skeletons until the day that you're forgotten on earth and then you fade away in this land. I'm okay with that. There's room in imagination for elaborating on reality, and we can imagine that God might have made the world differently than he did. But this is a film set in an ostensibly Catholic culture where we see crucifixes and churches and priests in collars and nuns, at least in the movies of that world, and Our Lady of Guadalupe on the wall. And there is no hope for an afterlife. There is no prayer. And when you fade away in the land of the dead, they tell us that that is the final death. And it's completely a materialistic outlook on what happens to you after you die. In this film, in this culture, I want to register my dissent for that. Does it ruin the film for me? No. I gave it a B-. I recommend it on the basis of all the other things that I said, but I think it's important to realize that there is this secular element in the film that is contrary to our faith, and it actually portrays the afterlife in a way that we need to realize goes against what we believe. So that's my answer. I'm sorry if it doesn't entirely satisfy you.
Jessica?
I just thought that Ektor says he doesn't know, and like he's obviously not, he didn't live the best life, so he's not, let's say, a spiritual guru. I see the film more as a whimsical idea of some kind of a purgatorial state. These seem to be good people for the most part. I mean, maybe not, I don't know. Like, it's obviously not following what we believe about purgatory, but we don't know a lot about that.
Sure.
Stage. And I agree, there's not overt prayer, but I don't know. It gets kids at least thinking about the afterlife and thinking about family and thinking about bigger things than, you know, trolls, which I like trolls.
So, and that's all fine. And, you know, to the pure, all things are pure. And it's certainly possible to enjoy the positive aspects without focusing as much on the problematic issues. One of the occupational hazards that comes with seeing an awful lot of films is that you wind up focusing like a laser on things that a lot of people will gloss over. And there's nothing wrong with glossing over some of these things. I am not able to do it, and so I stand by my review.
Jessica, thanks very, very much. Appreciate the call. 888-318-7884, the number. We're talking movies with the Pope of Movies, Deacon Stephen Gardanus.
Not the Pope of Movies.
Oh, I must have misheard there. I thought that you had appointed yourself Pope of Movies. I'm just kidding you. Let's talk a little bit about religious movies for a moment, if I can, or movies with kind of overt religious themes, because Jessica started us off in that direction. I suppose sometimes we have a... Well, there's a history of religious movies that are more their religious themes are of a higher quality than the movies themselves. How do you like that for a diplomatic way of saying that sometimes religious movies are corny?
And to an extent, that's true. I think we always have to remember the other side of that equation. As Madeleine L'Engle once said, "If it's bad art, it's bad theology."
I say that because I wanted to ask you about Paul the Apostle of Christ. I did not see it. So I wonder, here's an overtly and quite successful, Christian-themed movie. What's your take?
It's not bad artistically. So this film comes from Affirm Films. It's one of those. It's one of the faith-based imprints. This one is owned by Sony. Writer-director Andrew Hyatt, who also made a movie about Mary, Unseen by Me, Full of Grace. But it's got a great cast. I happen to know the person who cast this movie, and she's a person with Hollywood connections. She got Jim Caviezel to play St. Luke. James Faulkner from Game of Thrones plays the Apostle Paul. It's got Olivia Martinez, it's got John Lynch, Joanna Wally, and it portrays the last days of Paul the Apostle in prison in Rome in around, I think, 68 AD or AD 68. We see Aquila and Priscilla, some of the leading Christian people in Rome, dealing with the persecution, the Neronian persecution in the wake of the Great Fire of Rome. And the screenplay is pretty smart. It's got some interesting themes, and there are a lot of things about it that I liked. As a Catholic, I wanted to see a little bit more of, for instance, the influence of St. Peter in Rome, and whether he is about to be executed with Paul, or whether he was executed somewhat earlier, where are his successors, where are Linus and Clement and so forth. I felt like the movie, even though it was written and directed by a Catholic, Andrew Wyatt, was maybe being the outlook of it seems to me to be a little bit too evangelical in terms of lacking that hierarchical element or any kind of sacramental or liturgical element. But in spite of that, there are some solid theological and moral themes to the film, and it is pretty well written and well acted, and I did like it.
And I've been hearing, although I just don't do horror movies, but that this movie that John Krasinski made, A Quiet Place, is kind of a pro-life movie. I don't know if you had was that the take you had on it, or
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Really?
And I thought of A Quiet Place earlier in the show when you talked about the social dimension of going to movies, because it's really interesting when you go to the theaters and you watch this movie with a crowd of people and you watch the silence in the film kind of flow off of the screen and out into the movie theater. People are trying to be really quiet. This is a film, it's a kind of a post-apocalyptic story about an alien invasion and a family played by John Krasinski and his real-life wife, Emily Blunt. They have three children in the beginning, two children very, very quickly. An older girl, played by Millicent Simmons, who is deaf in real life, and her character is deaf, and then a younger son, Noah Jupe. And I found myself reflecting as I was watching the movie how rarely we see a movie with such a positively portrayed family, with a husband and wife who are so in tune with each other and who as parents sacrifice in such a loving way for their children. And, you know, in the context of the film with these monsters everywhere who will devour you if you make too much noise, that they're being in tune with each other and their ability to use sign language, for instance, because of the daughter's physical disability is obviously important, but it's also just a great portrayal of family life.
That's I'm very happy to hear that, because it's interesting what you said to me about the, or what you just said about the social aspect of it, because that's that people are responding by being quiet themselves out of either fear of these monsters or just this, the general atmosphere is getting quieter and quieter. That may be with, like I just said, I don't really do horror movies, and I don't, but that a horror movie really is made for the theater in a way, isn't it? It's supposed to be a social experience that we scream together.
I think that it is. There are some movies that are best experienced in the theater, and you know, the when a movie works, when it connects with its audience, the audience becomes a unit, and the fact that there are people around you responding the same way that you do, that does have value, and it's part of the power of cinema as a medium. I should also mention in the film, at an early point in the story, we see that the wife is pregnant, and you know, even though they're living in the apocalypse, this child is welcomed, and life is always good, even in the worst of circumstances.
Wonderful. I have to say, one of the greatest people in the history of the world, who is, I think, so even today still not appreciated for her brilliance and beauty and holiness, is Joan of Arc. And so I want to get you to talk about a couple of Joan of Arc movies when we come back. We got to take a quick break. Stephen Greidanis is our guest, movie critic extraordinaire, and we're going to talk a little bit more about more movies and take your calls after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
We live in an age of indifference. Does truth exist? Maybe. Is there a God? Who knows? Does it matter what religion you believe in? Probably not. If you think so, fine. I'm spiritual, but not religious. Apologist Matt Nelson says this indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates our culture. And rather than remain indifferent, he did something about it. In his new book, Just Whatever, Matt looks at the different kinds of indifference you likely encounter in your friends and family members, and maybe in yourself, and offers an antidote to the problem that plagues our age. Order your copy of Just Whatever today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know that Catholic Answers Live is on TV? What began as a monthly series on EWTN in April of 2017 is now going to be coming to you on a weekly basis. You can catch Catholic Answers Live TV Saturdays at 5 p.m. Eastern Time on EWTN, with an encore at 2:30 a.m. on Sundays. We'll also be available soon on Apple TV, Roku, and the Augustine Institute's multimedia platform, Form. Make a point of making Catholic Answers Live TV part of your weekly viewing, and we'll see you on the airwaves.
Do you want to end abortion, halt the attack on traditional marriage, and ensure religious freedom for ourselves and for our grandchildren? To do this, we must convert the culture. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a grassroots initiative that recognizes this need and takes it to the streets. If you're interested in peacefully sharing the gospel in your area, visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Wrapping up the work week with just a really fun hour talking about movies with the man who knows, Deacon Stephen Gradonis. I wonder, Deacon, how you feel about being called Deacon. Have you gotten used to it?
It's funny. People were calling me Deacon even before I was ordained. So I was actually used to it by the time that I was ordained. What still is taking a little bit of getting used to is how often people call me Father. And then I there's always this moment where I pause and I think, do I correct them or not?
Well, you should probably stop wearing a Roman collar and sitting in a confessional then. I mean, that's probably what's causing some, no? So how is it to be a deacon, though? I mean, it's 2 years, right, that you're a deacon?
I'm on my second year now, and it's wonderful. It's wonderful to serve God's church in this ministry. It is something that I felt called to for many, many years, and whether I am serving at the Mass or preaching or just handing out food in our church's food pantry, visiting people in the nursing home and bringing them the Eucharist, I feel just very strongly that this is where God has called me to be, and I'm so happy and pleased and thrilled.
Wonderful. Praise God for that. I mean, for those who are not Catholic and may not know, but within the Catholic Church, we have three levels of holy orders, and among them is a deacon, because deacon means different things in different Christian communities.
Yes.
And a deacon preaches at Mass, and a deacon serves in the community, and as it's like in many ways, you're like a bridge, kind of, between the clergy and the laity. I don't know if that's the right way to say it. Maybe I'm...
Well, there's something to that, because, you know, we have secular lives, and I have a 9-to-5 job that has nothing to do with religion or movies. And I do walk around wearing street clothes, you know, and then I go to church and I wear vestments and I stand up at the altar and I have my lines, you know, It's interesting and it's challenging to me to engage my faith and to find God in these very different areas of my life. I knew when I felt called to the diaconate that it was to serve God's church and to help other people, but it was also for the salvation of my own soul. And I find myself very much working out my own salvation with fear and trembling in this ministry.
Wow. And also you get to say when Mass is over. You're the only guy that gets to do it.
That's right. Nobody leaves until I say so.
Right, you're in charge. a movie that is somewhat obscure and is obscure to me, but if I can find it, I want to see it because Joan of Arc is one of my heroes, and I think should be one of everybody's heroes. She's that great a saint. Jeanette, The Childhood of Joan of Arc. Am I going to be able to find it, and is it worth seeing?
So earlier in the show, I mentioned that great quote from Pius XII, that man has shallows as well as depths in order to give you permission to watch mindless entertainment from time to time. I want to throw out another quote. This is from pastoral instruction, Communio et Progressio, from the 1970s. Which informs us that as Catholics, it is only right that we seek to acquire a truly Catholic taste, lowercase c, one that includes both the traditional and the latest forms of artistic expression, one that appreciates and understands the production of all nations, all cultures and subcultures. So this is the magisterial quote that tells us that watching movies with subtitles and watching obscure foreign films and art films is also part of our Catholic engagement with culture. So Jeanette, the Childhood of Joan of Arc is a really weird film. It's one of the most unique films I've ever seen. Mystical theology and musical eclecticism meets hagiography and headbanging in this film. It is a musical. And it starts out very naturalistic with Joan as a 9-year-old girl saying her prayers in a very pious way, singing to God as a young peasant girl might, just wandering the French countryside, but also struggling with the problem of evil, with the suffering of the world, with the suffering of war, with the fact that after 14 centuries of Christianity, there's still so much evil and suffering in the world. And did Jesus actually accomplish anything? And if you're very literate and very knowledgeable of your Catholic literature, you might recognize eventually that these lyrics come from the writings of the French Catholic poet Charles Péguy, P-E-G-U-Y, with a acute accent over the E. And Charles Péguy, who was an atheist at first, he wrote a epic series of poems on Joan of Arc. He later became a devout Catholic and wrote more about her. And this musical draws on both of these. And the film by Bruno Dumont really engages Péguy's theological vision in a really extraordinary way. I have never seen a film like it. And in spite of the fact that the music eventually takes on everything from rock and roll to electronica to headbanging heavy metal, I found it to be really respectful and a moving experience.
Oh, it was originally in French and it's dubbed or it's subtitled or?
Oh, subtitled, absolutely.
So it's going to be hard to find. I got to look around for it.
Yes, it's only playing, it's playing a few, if you go to my review at the National Catholic Register, there is a link to a website where you can look for play dates. It's playing at most like a week or two and here and there. So you'll be very, but eventually it will come out on streaming and Blu-ray and so forth, and then everybody will be able to catch up with it at some point.
All right.
Not that everyone will.
No, of course. No, but I'm intrigued because, you know, with her visions of St. Margaret and St. Catherine and St. Michael and all that, Joan's life is weird, but weird in the most wonderful way. So I'm glad they made a weird movie about her. I'm really looking forward to it if I can find it. You noted to me earlier that the Passion of Joan of Arc is 90 years old this year.
Yes, this is a film that every listener should know. The Passion of Joan of Arc, from 1928, classic silent film. Carl Dreyer, one of the 45 films in the Vatican Film List, one of the 15 films in the subcategory of religion, one of the most famous silent films ever made, crowned by one of the greatest performances ever recorded on film, Renée Falconetti as Joan of Arc. This is exclusively concerned with her trial. And it's a movie that is a challenge to watch artistically because of how Dreyer breaks the rules of cinematic storytelling in order to kind of throw you off and make you not anticipate and stand back, but kind of sweep you along in these series of images as Joan's interlocutors, these theologians and judges of the church, grill her. And as she's so weary and she's so exhausted and fearful, and she just tries to deal with it all. And you really kind of go through Joan's passion with her. I have never seen a film that brings me spiritually into the experience of Good Friday as much as The Passion of Joan of Arc. Oh, and it's new. There's a new Blu-ray from the Criterion Collection. So.
Ah, thank you very much for that recommendation. I will look for that. Another religious movie or religious themed movie. I think it's also in limited release in different places, but you'll have to tell me the Devil and Father Amorth is not in wide release, is it?
You know, where I am, it's in theaters, but I live near New York City, so I'm not really sure exactly how wide the release is, but it's a film that has something of a high profile, only because of the director. So William Friedkin is forever known as the director of The Exorcist, and now he's made this documentary about the world's best-known exorcist, Father Amort, the author of books that you can buy from Ignatius Press. He was an exorcist of the Diocese of Rome until his recent death in 2016, and he is seen here performing an exorcism on a woman who is called in the film, she's called Christina, whether that's her real name or not. And we see interviews with another, with a brother and sister, who the sister was successfully exorcised by Father Amort, we're told. And then we have interviews with a whole bunch of talking head psychologists and medical experts, and even Bishop Robert Barron, the auxiliary bishop of the Archdiocese of Los Angeles. So there's some interesting stuff in the film and also some head-scratching stuff. And I wish I could recommend it more than I can, because in the end, there are too many things about the movie that I have reservations about, starting with the fact that I just can't get past the fact that the woman who's being exorcised, when we hear her voice, it's been digitally tweaked. It's been, there's a audio effect called chorus effect that makes you sound like you're a possessed person in a horror movie. And that's what they've done.
So that takes the air of authenticity off of it then.
It absolutely does. You know, I was watching it with my 14-year-old daughter, and as soon as she spoke, my daughter said to me, "Is that really what she sounded like?" And it sounded fake to me, fake enough that I put it in my review. Then I heard an actual audio clip from the original audio. There was a piece on this that ran in, I can't remember which online journal. I'll think of it in a minute. You can hear it online, the original audio. And she sounds like a woman who's just talking in a guttural voice, but a totally normal sounding woman. That's not to say she wasn't possessed, whether she was or she wasn't. I can't speak to that. But when you watch the movie, you're seeing Hollywood. You're not seeing reality, and that's unfortunate.
I can see that. Yeah. Let's just take a little score. You did recommend, am I correct, A Quiet Place? Or you said that's worth seeing?
Oh, absolutely. Strongly.
And both of the Joan of Arc movies, The Passion of Joan of Arc and Jeanette, The Childhood of Joan of Arc?
Absolutely. Avengers Infinity War, if you're a fan of the Marvel franchise, you're going to be there.
And Paul, Apostle of Christ, you also gave that
another recommend. Good movie.
Very good. Deacon Stephen Graydonis has been our guest. Deacon, thank you so much for an hour of movies. Do you think we could do like a summer movie preview at some point and have you on just preview the movies?
That'd be great,
Zach. Okay, very good. May we have your blessing before we go.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord be gracious unto you and give you his peace now and forever in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you again, Deacon. I really appreciated that hour.
Thank you so much.
Well, we've done it. We've come to the end of the work week. Hope you're home by now. Hope the traffic was all right. Jesus Christ is the light of the nations. And we'll see you next time on Catholic Answers Live.